Go video. Go live. Once again, experimenting around with another piece of software, bringing these a whopping 16 programs that I'm trying to stream with now, and the audio might be way imbalanced. So before I do like my introductions and all that, I need to make sure that that's actually working, because it never works. Of course. Regarding Saturday. Also, I'm gonna name this because I just figured out that I could actually declare my stream and the game I'm playing with a title, and it'll appear in the navigational menu that Twitch uses. I'm just like super stupid. Okay, so last week I kind of did a stream on Blood Death Knights. I kind of just like covered tips and tricks. Something I forgot to mention was that... I did a stream on Blood Death Knights, and something I forgot to clarify is, like, I'm not an expert at Blood Death Knights. I consider myself to be decently good enough to talk about subtle nuances about it. But, you know, this is not, like, my main... Like, so... Anything that I talk about that isn't priest-related, it's coming from someone who plays those tunes as alts, so if I make a mistake or something, happily comment on my mistakes, or stuff that I'm, like, saying that's wrong information, because those aren't my main tunes, but I do, and it's not like I'm trying to discredit myself, I do have a lot of information about all of the tunes in World of Warcraft, like, all these different classes, but it's not my priest, so I'm not expert at it, I guess. And I guess I'm self-declaring myself as an expert on priesting, but... This week, another subtle nuance of a class is, Assassination Rogues. I figured that would be, like, a good class to cover because, you know, everyone's being tricked into playing the legendaries. Or, play them in a PvE context so they could get the legendaries. That's what Blizzard's trying to do. and I'm actually not playing an Assassination Rogue this time. Around, like, I'm not playing it this patch really because I didn't want to be roped into that mess of like being tricked into playing it. So it feels like, but I do want to kind of talk about the rotation a bit. So let's see if we're like gonna get started here. If we're getting started early, I'll just talk about it while I'm clearing on my priest. If not, I can actually fully switch over to the tune. If I can switch over to the tune, I can like show and demonstrate while I'm talking, guys. As this stuff is happening to me. Hey, Sombras. Huh, weird. We're like not online. Hopefully we didn't cancel. If we canceled, I need to quickly find another run. Nope, we're going. Okay, cool. And I apologize. Alright, I'm gonna talk about Assassination Rogues on my Rogue. So I'm gonna hop over to that tune. Now, like I said, I haven't been playing this tune, like, at all this entire patch, so its gear's pretty crap. There we go. Okay. So the things I wanted to talk about, like, you can find on any site kind of, like, the way you're gonna do an assassination rotation. But I wrote down a few things that I wanted to cover that are still, like, not super intuitive. One of them is, like, your poisons. There are conflicting like sites out there that talk about poison application to your weapons. Obviously, you always want to have instant poison on your main hand, and you always want to have deadly poison on your offhand. This is because when your deadly poison stacks up to 5, every time it does another application, it instantly applies whatever's on your main hand. So, the conflicting information is that people sometimes substitute instant poison in or deadly with wound poison. and something else, you want to put your deadly poison on your throwing weapon at all times. The reason they do that is because deadly wound poison has a higher application rate than instant poison, so that's where the confusion is coming from. So in like an AoE fest, or something you're going to zerg down in less than like 10 seconds, like that's just a mic estimate number, that's why they say, oh, sometimes you'll put on wound poison. In my opinion, just always, always put on instant poison on this hand, like in your main hand, and then always put deadly poison on your off hand. And always put deadly poison on your throwing weapon as well, because even though there's a ramp up time, the percentage chance for instant poison to be applied while you're applying the deadly poison, even before it's 5 stacks, is like still around 40%, which in my mind is justified. And that will also guarantee a crippling poison application because you're mutilate or assassination spec. So the TLDR is just always have your poison set up instant, deadly, deadly, if you just want to skip the whole lecture. So that's my beef with poisons. What that also means is instant poison, the way it procs is like if you have a fast weapon, it's going to proc at a slower rate because it's based on the number of procs per minute. So if you have a fast weapon, it's going to be a slower application rate. If you have a slow weapon, like a slow swing speed, then it's going to be a higher application rate because not only is it going to apply from the chance, like proc per minute white damage, but all of those yellow damage attacks that you're doing, like your combo point builders and finishers, are going to apply instant poison as well. So that's something that often gets missed. So yeah, like just set yourself straight, get the poisons correct. Okay, so your basic rotation, there's some little subtle things to kind of note. Like anything will tell you that, okay, basically you want to keep up slice and dice, you want to keep up rupture, and you want to do mutilate, and venom, unless it's under 35%, and then instead of doing mutilate, do backstab. I mean, that's like technically right, that is the rotation, but the subtle points of it are, I mean, it's pretty much like strictly on your energy gains. So your energy gains are kind of measured by like this. When you open, you get this buff called Overkill that gives you additional energy. Your additional energy is also coming from any bleeds that are on the target, so you always want to open with Garrow because it'll have this chance to proc energy. Faster gains for energy means faster DPS. So yeah, always open with like a bleed. Once you get your bleed up, get another bleed up, which is Rupture. Now, the subtle nuance with Rupture is that the amount of Rupture damage you're going to do over the course of a fight, it's kind of a small percentage, and that really the reason you're keeping that up on a target isn't so much that the dot is doing a lot of damage, it's that it's proccing extra energy. So you just want to have 100% uptime on it, but that's why sites will say keep Rupture up. Some of them actually go so far to say that it doesn't matter how many combo points you have when you refresh it. So yeah, that's true. Like, you don't really need to worry about like how many combo points are on your target when you refresh Rupture, but if you're looking ahead at kind of like how much energy you're gaining versus how many combo points you're spending on mutilates and envenoms, then you can kind of judge, like, okay, I can finish with a higher point Rupture here versus wherever, or I have like a temporary bonus, like an agility bonus from my engineering or my landslide enchants or whatever, like that nonsense. So that's kind of like, yeah, that Rupture just gets tricky. But okay, like once you have all those things going, get Slice and Dice up, and then you never have to worry about Slice and Dice again, because when you do a finisher, it'll refresh itself to its full duration. Alright, now what we're talking about with your basic, like, mutilate and venom rotation, you get this like term thrown around called energy pooling. Energy pooling is like as such follows. When you're doing this finisher move, it puts up this buff, right, in venom. Now, in venom increases the application to your poisons, so what you want to do is fit like as many quick attacks as you can during that in venom period as possible. So when you go to do a finisher, like if you're totally starved for energy, like say you're totally out of energy, like right here, I'm out of energy. If I press this, there's no other combo point generator moves that I can do. Like, I can't do another mutilate because I was out of energy when I cast it. So what it means to energy pool is, instead of like doing your finisher move like as fast as humanly possible, wait until your energy is kind of like a little bit pooled up so you can fit in some mutilates after you finish. Like here, I finish and I can immediately start doing mutilates again. And I'm doing 2 mutilates, which is 4 extra hits during the period of that one in venom, if you just saw there. So it's kind of quick, like it happens fast. You need to make these split-second decisions with your energy because your energy is going to be regenerating at different rates depending on, like, you know, the number of bleeds that you have in the target, if you just came out of stealth, if you're under any haste modifiers, like there's a lot of trinkets that give you haste modifiers, and there's also heroism, like big buffs like that, that's going to screw with your energy regen. So you kind of have to like adjust your energy pooling appropriately. And then the other trick with this is always, like, at these haste levels, it used to be like finish at 4 or 5 combo points, but at these haste and crit levels, just finish at 3 to 5 points and do your finisher. So, if you're at 3, it'll be a slower duration, but wait for the buff to fall off, don't cap out on energy, and then you can fit in more attacks in that next attack, and then you can pull your energy up again, wait, and then do your finisher. Okay, so those are like the... And that's really, like, that's what's going to separate you from good and bad rogues, is that kind of a skill cap, energy pooling-wise. So, yeah, that's kind of tricky. The other tricky nuance about being an assassination rogue is your two cooldowns that you have are Vendetta, which you really want to use when you're going to get the maximum amount of uptime, and you want to use Vanish, because Vanish, when you come back out of stealth, you can get another bleed, and when you're coming out of stealth, you'll have that faster energy regen. So you kind of want to pair those two together, but if you compare the two, you'll see that, like, Vanish is a 3-minute cooldown, Vendetta is a 2-minute cooldown, so they're not always going to line up. This also means some pretty weird stuff is happening when you do your opener, because, like, if you're going to pre-pot, you know, and you want to put up, like, a Vendetta, you have to, like, pre-pot, then stealth, then run in Vendetta your target, open on it, do whatever. And if your energy is still, like, pulling up, you don't want to cast Vanish right away, because if you re-stealth and open again, then you're reapplying those bleeds before they expired, and the overkill buff that you had from coming out of stealth is still rolling. You don't want to overlap that. So, using your cooldowns, it's a little bit easier in my mind to do, like, quick burst if you're sub, and if you are just kind of like using your bursts off cooldown, then you should play combat, because this is definitely like a thinking man's cooldown rotation if you're playing assassination, because if you like screw up your Vendetta or your Vanish usage, then you're going to be like out a ton of DPS. Like, you're going to be probably last in the DPS meters, because that's how critical it is that you do max throughput during those two cooldowns. So that's like one of the things you got to worry about. Also, Cold Blood, make sure you're using that on Envenom. Don't use it on Mutilate. And also, look at Cold Blood as a, okay, you want to use it on Venom if you have, like, procs going, like, you have a 2 landslide enchants and, like, an agility trinket going, then, yeah, click Cold Blood and Venom, get this, like, really big in Venom, but also, it's an energy regen, so if your energy's starved and your rotation is about to suffer for it, I mean, you could, situationally, Cold Blood and get 25 instant energy from doing that finishing move, because since you're using it on Envenom, you're pretty much guaranteed to get that energy back from using Envenom, and then you're also getting 25 energy from activating Cold Blood. So those are the nuances of your cooldowns. You also need to be mindful of target switching, so redirect. It's not something you're going to be as critically using like combat would be, but your redirect ability is something you want to use when you're like switching targets if you have like a good ramp up on a previous target or something, because think about it, you have to like get all your dots and crap going again, so if you can just combo transfer those over and you're kind of close to full energy by the time you run over there, you can like get your rotation going faster on that target and not lose a whole lot of DPS. It does not transfer Vendetta, so that's something that you might goof up if you're coming from combat, so yeah, don't try to transfer Vendetta with your redirect. Okay, so those are all the subtle nuances of playing Assassination Rogue that I can think of off the top of my head. Your glyphs pretty much have Mutilate, have Rupture at all times, and then have Glyph of Backstab unless you're facing an enemy that you can't get behind, like Sinestra. In the case you want to switch out Backstab to Vendetta. Which I didn't even learn, because like I said, I'm not playing this rogue. So you want to switch out from Vendetta if you're not able to backstab something. My opinion, like, I mean, major glyphs kind of aren't as big of a crutch, but my opinion is always have Tricks of the Trade glyph, because, like, energy regen is critical for you. So anything you can do to not use too much energy, that's good. Glyph of Faint is also, like, free if you use this glyph, and it's a really good boon to your raid to use Faint. The reason I think these two should always be glyphed is because, like, this now is, like, tied to your tier bonuses, so glyphs tricks of the trade you want to have, like, no energy spent on, and that's pretty much why you glyph it. But Faint, like, if you notice, if you're sitting here pooling your energy and you're doing your rotation or whatever, let's get my rotation going, there's like some downtime when you're like doing your rotation, like while you're waiting for the energy to pool up before you like do your finisher again. So while you're waiting for that energy to pool up, well, you know, press feint, like do something to help out your raid, and if feint is free, like essentially you're not wasting that global cooldown because you're just waiting for your energy to pool anyway. So anything you can do to like help people out, do it. Anyway. So that's my take on rogues. Let's see if there's anything else I kind of forgot about. I think it's a really fun rotation. You know, it's a melee class, so if you haven't done something basic like put your keybinds AS, pretty much unbind S times is like my opinion, but melee classes, I leave it bound. You want to make sure that your spells are on your keyboard and that your mouse is the thing that's primarily moving you around, because like if you're sitting there keyboard turning or like clicking your abilities, the amount of time it takes for you to like go back to your like after you click an ability and then like move to catch up, like if the boss suddenly moves on you and you have to keep doing DPS, like you're losing tons of DPS because you just didn't bind your keys correctly. So I mean, as a melee, it's super critical to at least have that level of skill cap down. Let's see what else. Because you're a melee, you really have to worry about positioning more. But, I mean, it's not such a spaz rotation that you're just like getting locked up and hammering your keys as fast as possible, because you're kind of like pooling your energy, waiting for a finisher. Like, it's kind of a... It feels like smooth to me. I like it, and you can focus on stuff like, oh, you know, my tank is backpedaling the boss into next week. I need to, like, stay at its backside, keep forking away at it. So, yeah, make sure you're keybound correctly. With melee, you gotta reach that extra skill cap just by mobility. And you're a rogue. You also have, like, a million awesome buttons. If, you know, something were to go awry, you can, like, tank for a small period of time, like evasion tank, and you can like you can vanish from combat and res people for a quick wipe, even though you should be using that as a DPS cooldown. Sometimes it's such that it lines up that way. You could also what else are we looking into? Cloak of Shadows, like try to abuse that in every encounter. That's like one of my favorite abilities in the game, so yeah, try to use that to your advantage, because it's awesome. It's one of the best survivability cooldowns. Like, that's the thing, I play all of the melee classes, and although rogue wears leather, which is technically the squishiest of all the melee classes, it feels like it's the best at surviving stuff, comparatively, to everything. Like, even the blade classes. I guess something I didn't talk about with Rupture, since it's a dot, you do want to refresh it like right before its duration ends, because there's a dead time where you're not getting that extra chance to proc a chunk of energy because it like fell off the target and it didn't do a dot, and then you reapplied it and then there's a little bit of a delay before it like starts ticking again. So yeah, make sure you refresh your Rupture on time. It's like all dots, just do it right, clip it right at the end. And yeah, like if you kind of want to like see ahead where things are going. It's like, okay, how much time is left on Rupture? You know, where am I sitting combo point wise? Kind of make some like interesting decisions, and you can maximize your damage based on like that Rupture, even though you technically don't really need to worry about how many combo points you're using to use Rupture as a finisher. So that'll separate you from the baddies. And pooling your energy, like just like waiting, doing an envenom, and then doing your mutilates like after an envenom, that'll separate you from a baddie assassination rogue who's playing it like combat, where you're just mashing things off cooldown. So that's something to look at. Also, something to look at for future weeks. Like, I do have all 10 classes raid ready that I can go into their PvE rotations. So if you wanna, like, see your class explained by me, like, and I'm not just saying class, like, class and spec. Like, there's a difference there. So, if you want to see a particular spec in this game explained, I mean, you'd be able to use it for a couple months before they completely change it for Mists, but, you know, it's never too late. You can, like, you know, drop in a comment or something, like, on a, like, all of my past streams are on YouTube. I kind of advertise on the WoW general forums, like, the day of. So, yeah, I'm, like, actively looking at those sites if you were to, like, leave a comment or something. I can, you know, specifically, like, go over that particular class or spec that you want to see. Because I know that my streams have been mostly, like, here's my priest, here's me healing, a different way, here's me healing yet another way, and then here's me doing, like, shadow DPS once. And then, like, I've kind of not really done a whole lot of other classes, so that's why I'm trying to branch out, and that's why I did Death Knights last week, to try to, like, broaden my information spread across, like, other avenues and other peoples that would not normally see it. So yeah, that's why I also decided to cover Assassination Rogues tonight, while we're waiting to form. And we're still selling the mounts, gold runs. I think that's why I'm not raiding on these tunes, that I'm just kind of like hitting up a dummy and doing a verbal explanation. If I was in a raid, it could probably further explain more. I'm not doing those raids with those tunes because we're selling the mounts on Tuesday nights still to clients. What that means is if you have 200k gold floating around in your pocket and you want to see all of the heroic content, which for Razien, R-A-Z-I-E-N, and he'll get you set up with a date and time with our 10-man, and we can carry you basically through to Heroic Madness, and at the end you are guaranteed the mount that drops off of Heroic Madness, which is going to decrease in drop rate come this next expansion to about 1%. So if you want to get it now, you kind of want to get it now. So yeah, we'll carry you to that mount, and then for the most part, we're like pretty much best in slot, so you're almost guaranteed all of the gear. I think you put up a posting on the Shadow Song forums of the gear that we can't, that we're like still farming for, that we probably wouldn't pass to, but it's really not like something, like our gear priority that we were told was that, you know, our main specs, that's the gear priority that we're still hunting for, which is not a whole lot. Off specs gear for us, that's actually below the priority list underneath you, the client. So if you are coming with us and, like, you know, one of us needs something for an off spec, you have the first dibs on it. So you're pretty much like guaranteed all of the gear if you run through. And, like, the really important gear is already taken care of. Like, we already have trinkets and weapons and our tier pieces. I'm trying to remember, like, I mean, I looked at the list of, like, what we still could possibly use, and it wasn't much. It was basically, like, the rare drop rings. But, I mean, the other rings are fair game. Like, we've already gotten all of them, so, yeah. Check it out. Whisper Razien if you're interested in that. Gonna tap out and see if this is like browsable, this stream, because I want to make sure that people can actually find it. I had no idea that you could set up your like Twitch. Like, I had no idea that you could change the title of your stream while you were streaming it. I always do that after the fact and then I re-upload it to YouTube. So that was like a big shocker to me that, oh, you can like list the title as you're streaming. That's super cool. So that was a learning experience for me. And then also, you can declare, like, the game that you're playing. There's a community of people that are all playing these different games, and you can just, like, it's as simple as, like, going down through the navigational menu and saying, oh, I want to see, like, Street Fighter 4, so I'm going to click on that, and there's, like, the whole listing of people that are all playing those games. That's really cool. I didn't know that was, like, a thing. By the way, we're listening to Sumac, S-M-A-C-K, band that broke up, but they're from California. This album came out like maybe 10 years ago or so. Still really good. It's called Now Hear This, if you want to buy it. I would recommend you buy it. It's like really good. I thought about live streaming D3. Basically, I stopped playing D3, and I haven't checked up on it in a while, but I'm looking at it now, and there's a lot of stuff that's changed. Like, there is a lot of... that there's a lot of like better resources out there for seeing like D3, like how to do like the most DPS, how to do the like best build, where to get the best gear. Like, I mean, there's just been a lot more research on it than last time I looked at it. So, I mean, maybe someday I'll look up, maybe I'll do some D3 info someday. But as of right now, nope. I am focusing on WoW Cataclysm streaming. I'm also looking into doing some raids in the beta, like the Mists of Pandaria beta, but I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to wait until the public test realm comes out before I start doing those raids, streamed anyway. I guess here's some review for like those who missed it. Because that's the thing, I just have so many hours of material now that if you were to like hit up my YouTube account today and you've never seen it before, you just get overloaded with information. So here's kind of like some stuff you missed. I've talked quite a bit about cancel casting. There are two ways to cancel cast. You can wait until the very end of your cast and move. You do this to make sure your heal is 100% effective, so if your target is about to get like a ton of overhealing, you move at the last second and start recasting, so when they're at lower health, your heal is more efficient. So that's a mana-saving technique. The other way of cancel casting is doing it at the beginning of your cast. This is if you're like trying to line up your big heal to land like right after some predictable damage. The best way I can describe like an example is dragons. Like when they do breath, it's always like they're getting ready and they start casting it. Like you can look in your boss timers and see that, okay, breath about to go out, like it's about to hit. Or I guess like the more practical application is impales now on Madness of Deathwing. You can see like, okay, the impale's about to go out, just move around, do this, and then like once the impale starts casting, actually let your cast fully finish and land right after it hits. That serves a couple purposes. One, it gets the target that just took the big hit up in health really fast, which is nice, because that's like, that's good for like stabilizing people from just like not getting insta-gibbed. But the other thing is it helps out the other healers, because, you know, think about it, if they're just like floating around not doing anything, and all of a sudden like a big hit happens and it like drags someone down to like the 20% health range, they're wasting their heals trying to get that person back up to, like they'll probably use like inefficient heals if they weren't like predicting where it was coming from. So that's bad news. So not only is like doing cancel casting in that mannerism good for your good for your other healing team, but it's also good for like keeping people stabilized. Like there's lots of benefits to doing that type of cancel casting. However, something I don't think I talked about was don't like sit there and cancel cast and cancel cast and cancel cast so much that you're not actually doing healing. Like, I mean, you gotta let some healing go by. You need to let some level of overhealing happen. So don't like totally neglect it. I mean, that's something that I'm afraid of, is I put this out in the atmosphere and all of the people who are learning to heal look at it and go, oh, yeah, cancel casting, that's like really cool. I guess that's what separates the good healers from the bad. I'm gonna just cancel cast all the time. It's like, no, I mean, there's like a time to do it, but there's also a time to let your healing just go through, because every class in the game that's a healer has some method of handling overhealing. So yeah, take care, don't go crazy with it. And that's another thing, I did a stream a couple of weeks back about like explaining how to go through here and how to like manage mana really well. Like I had the stream set up to where I completely reforged out a spirit, and I was playing as Holy, which is a very, like, spirit-dependent spec. So, I mean, like, yeah, I set this up, and I kind of thought I wouldn't be able to do it, but it actually went really smoothly because my intellect is so high, so I have such a big mana pool. But I was doing all these crazy, like, mana-saving techniques. Like, I was stance-dancing, like, back and forth, and I was, like, really managing my, like, you know, mana cooldowns with, like, my procs, that kind of stuff. There's a time to do that, but, you know, sometimes you don't want to go save all of your mana, because, like, think of mana as, like, a resource that could be spent. If you were to execute a fight perfectly, as the boss dies, you should be casting your last heal, and then be fully depleted from mana. you'll see me try to, like, manage that on some of the tougher fights that still give us problems. Like, pretty much, like, with this nerf that's gone out, I mean, nothing's really that challenging except for the last two fights in Dragon Soul, but you'll see me trying to, like, end the fight right at the end of my mana, and there's been a couple weeks in the past where I didn't actually manage it that well, and, like, had, like, 2 seconds left on the boss being alive, and I was, boom, just, like, running on fumes. Yeah, so I, like, flip on my Heart Song weapon and try to, like, get it back and keep people alive just for those last couple seconds. So, yeah, don't, like, I mean, the mana saving techniques that I was demonstrating is to show you, like, how you could theoretically, like, game your mana a bit better, but something you don't want to do is, like, game your mana so much that you're sitting at full mana and you're not really doing healing. Like, you know, because all of these mana saving techniques, although they do save mana, they do kind of sacrifice your healing per second. If you're only doing, like, half the healing per second that you're capable of, that means that your other healers are picking up your slack, and you're stressing them out, and they're wasting their mana trying to pick up your slack. And that's bad, because you're saving your personal mana. They're the ones that are, like, because they were trying to save you, or, like, trying to cover for you. It'd be better if you guys just all worked together and used, like, medium mana usage. Then everybody would be happy, and that's just better for, like, the group, because, you know, you don't know when one healer's gonna be running out of fire, or, like, when one healer is wrapped up or busy or DCing, or, like, I mean, there's so many things that could possibly happen to your heal team. So, yeah, don't go, like, overboard with these games that I'm demonstrating. Something that's important to say. I wish I was female sometimes. I'm not, like, getting money to do this stream or anything, but it would be nice to get more views. If I, like, when I discovered this Twitch browsing thing, like, I saw that all of the top streams were basically, like, sponsored, so they are getting money to do it. But, like, the streams that were, like, me, just, like, people talking about WoW, they were all, like, pretty much, like, hot girls. Hot girls and really highly rated arena people that weren't sponsored yet, so it's a tough world out there. Thought it would be funny. I don't have any, like, I don't have a girlfriend or anything like that in real life, so I thought it would be funny, like, if I did, if I would, like, bring them into the room and be like, hey, I'm about to live stream to a bunch of people about World of Warcraft. So you should, like, sit down in my chair and pretend it's you, so you're in the thumbnail, and then when people click on it, they'll be expecting, like, some hot girl, and they'll like, end up seeing my dumb face. Thought about it, but that's too manipulative. And I'm giving myself too much credit. If I had a girlfriend, she would be ugly. I might go and just, like, start playing Fire Mage, show you kind of what that looks like. Why not? Because, like, okay, the order of preference, since I don't, like, have comments or responses for which classes that I should view, I'm kind of looking at them and thinking, like, oh, well, I'll just do the ones that weren't intuitive for me when I was first learning that spec. So that's why I'm doing stuff like, you know, Assassination Rogue to me was not an intuitive spec, that's why I did that one this week. And, like, Death Knights, that was another spec that, like, didn't just make sense right off the bat. So, yeah. Like, that's the method to why I'm doing this. But yeah, Fire Mages, like, a single target Fire Mage DPS rotation made a lot of sense, like, that wasn't too complicated. However, if you do AoE, it gets a little bit more tricky. So that's kind of, I could hop on there and show a few tricks on it. And like I said, I did Blood Death Knights last week. So that's like, since I've covered all the priest specs, it's like 5 specs down out of the 30, I'm going to say 31, because Feral Druids, like, the cats play differently than bears. Well, I mean, it's the same spec, but they spec differently, and I could do that in 2 different covers. Everybody James steps into the train. Her way is the Should probably hop in vents so I can hear what my guildies are saying. I always forget to sign an event. How do you pronounce your name? Platinstock? I like his transmog. That's what my helm looks like in my shadow set. Maybe I might have changed it. Dear. Alright, I changed it to Old War set. For a while, I had it to the Sinister cloth, which is what he's wearing. These are the things that occur on the subway. These are the ways we subdivide our time. Let's get this dream underway. And the turnstiles keep turnstiling around. I don't know why I'm doing that. I'm just being a jerk for no reason. And so on and so on and so on. And so on and so on and so on. And so on and so on and so on down the line. Kinda wish Seth were here. Seth, get it at a Dragon Soul so we can life group you through the portal. I don't know why I like picking on him so much. I've looked into doing, like, that guy I just, like, hovered over that was an icon. I looked into doing the insane title on this tune a couple times, actually. Like, this isn't something I've been totally neglecting. It's, like, I usually don't pay a whole lot of attention to achievements, but, you know, for the ones that are really challenging that look like they're gonna, you know. We're divvying up our tasks. I've never run with, like, a third of the group that's in our group right now. It's just to say, like, how this run may or may go. I think we're all geared, but it's just funny, because each week we're, like, losing more and more of our original 10-man. But that's just what happens in the summer. Like, summer is like a... If you're a raid leader and you're having trouble getting people to come on at this time of year, it's because it's summer. It's not you. It's not the group. I mean, this time it's really unfortunate, because it's, like, both summer and it's also the end of a raid cycle, so there's not as many people that are willing to go out and, I guess, play. Which is funny, because that's, like, the whole point of this stream, is I wanted to, like, teach people who were missing that gap between, like, heroic mode raiding and normal mode raiding. That's the reason I do this. So... Oh... I don't know. I do what I can. But yeah, like, if you are having those attendance problems, it's because it's summertime, it's not you. Don't worry about it. It'll get fixed. By the way, the song we're listening to right now is kind of how I got hooked on this band. This was at a TV show. I don't remember which one, though. It was in a good TV show, because I only watch good TV. Yeah, whatever. I don't know. I was watching this show, and this song came on, and I was just like, this is amazing! So I kind of, like, rewatched it, got a bit of the lyrics, and looked it up later, and that's how I discovered this band, which, like, turned out to be really awesome. Also, if you missed, like, the last couple of weeks, I basically went engineering, so that's, like, new, different. Must be broken. Defend the line. love pulling two packs of trash, let me tell you. I also love standing in that. I knew that was gonna happen. Oh well, maybe I can run in and fix this. It's one of the perks of using HODs, is you are just like a constant aggro machine. Okay, the group that I'm with is not comfortable with me, like, broadcasting our vent conversations, but I can summarize basically what was going on there was, what was that? Well, that was me getting a little closer than I expected. Sorry about that. Nobody's, like, mad or intense or crazy in this group. I found some footage of this guild I was, like, looking at. I don't even remember why I was, like, looking at him. I think it was, well, when I was looking up people who had, like, two-healed madness. So I was, like, looking at this guild that had two-healed madness, and, like, their vent was just, like, so serious, and everyone was, like, freaking out, like, all the time. They were just like, you gotta take this seriously, we're doing heroic raiding, and they were, like, getting all up in each other's faces, and it's, like, one guy screwed up, and they just, like, laid into him. You know, those guys are a little bit higher ranked than us, but not that much higher ranked than us. So I would say, like, don't worry about that. Like, just keep your vent, keep your raid chill. Don't, like, act like a jerk. Hey, baby. I'm looking for a good time. And I'm lonely. Please come to this address after raid so I can feel better about my life. What's his only option? So many agree. Same chair he has today since they threw the cane away. And man, he wasn't doing nothing, he just doing his own thing. You know it gets really caught out by the jump. Okay, for those who are new, the way I do this fight is to just stay a little bit ahead on healing. The way I do that is I just pre-stack Divine Aegis with Prayer of Healing. It's pretty simple. And then before, like, big stomps, just get out bubbles on the two melee, then I get bubbles on the range. You're about to take this, like, pinky crazy explosion, whatever the hell it's called. This is always really predictable at the start. It always does this. Like, it does like two pinky spawns and then like pulls you in. So you can pretty much like always guarantee that that's gonna happen. This looks like a good enough place to stand, if any. Of course I can't reach. My hooker responded. Shield. Ooh. Oh man, throwing up a little. You know what, I'm just gonna delete this friggin' quest item. I swear I've gotten so many of those, I don't even care anymore. Oh man. Don't you love it when you accidentally earn achievements? Like, here's what just happened, for those who missed it. Accidentally earn achievements without even trying. We're just like, whoa! Didn't even know that he hadn't gotten that yet. Oh, also in that fight, this is the hand that does Archangel Bubbles and Mending and Renew and Penance. This is the hand that does like Prayer of Healing, Greater Heal, Flash Heal, and all of that. So I was texting, that's why I was like prayer heal spamming, but you kind of saw like how to weave in smites for the beginning of the fight anyway. It's like get the stacks going at first when you have the downtime, but then once like the rotation starts going out, it's very predictable damage. You don't want to waste a whole lot of time like smiting because you need to get in 4 prayer of heal casts in order to cap ages on people. So you want to weave in like mostly holy fires and maybe the occasional smite, which means you're not going to have it like running on cooldown every 30 seconds. Oh, and shoot, I keep forgetting to put my... I keep forgetting to put the camera pointed at the other group. That's the thing I've realized about the last couple weeks. I've never, like, captured the other group in my live streams. It's always, like, our immediate group. I keep forgetting I need to, like, zoom out and point at the other direction. Oh well. Love rocket fuel leaks. Let me tell you, it's, like, my favorite thing. I swear, these boots, like, they're not boots, they're boosts now, nitro boosts. I swear the way they work is, for the first, like, 10 casts or something, they never fail. That's how it's supposed to work. I swear that's, like, what's going on behind the scenes there. And then, after that, 50% chance that they'll fail, like, every time. Here I am, like, I was all excited that they would work reliably when I needed them, but nope. I guess that wasn't like I needed to use my boots there, it's just trying to like boost myself into the trash faster, so it's not like clutch that I need to get over there super fast. These little red dots that are popping up in my healer frames, that's the aggro dot. I know that Grid has its own version of this, but it like literally only procs when like something is being tanked. The Voodoo version of it is much better because it procs all the time from weird stuff like the target is suddenly switching and dropping a debuff on you, so it's really nice for a Disciplined Priest to be using something that can show that. Nope, gold. Forgot to buy water again. Whoops. Oh well. They'll probably explain the DPS have to assign priority targets to go to, so they'll probably like sit there and explain that. Basically, our two dot classes always go off to the right here during the black phase, and they dot cleave two targets down, so neither of those targets like drop very fast. And then the warrior always goes to this green target, burns it down, and jumps to the claw. Claw is like right over here, and cleaves it. It's usually our mage and our enhancement shaman go out here, but they burn down like one target at a time, because the faster they can burn down their target one at a time. Resto? How many healers do we have? Okay, I have like no idea who's going where, so I'm just like guessing and putting bubbles on everybody. Cause like frankly, I just have like no clue. Reset, mana pool! You bad internet. Okay, what I just did there, since I don't know like I don't even know who's healing. I think it's this Aurelia person. I don't even know who that is. I think that's like one of the puggers that we just brought in, but I don't know like which direction they were running. So I just like got some bubbles on the two range, made sure that they were like at full health. The two that were like running off to the side, like the two dot classes that were running out to where my mouse is swirling. Like once I got those two rolling, then I. And then, like, went back to the other group, basically. That was unintentional, by the way. God. Some little tricky micromanaging there. I didn't get to demonstrate because the boss died, but what I was trying to do is I love getting compliments. Seriously. Basically, okay, what I did there is a single general remained. We accidentally the ranged group missed the circle bounce. Like we really screwed up basically. So the entire group misses it. I was like, oh crap, that went right by me. So I threw on my engineering boots and boosts and flew to the back of the room. I'm pretty much gonna get one shot. Even with pain stuff, it was really dicey when we were learning the fight. Maybe it's nerfed now, I don't know. But the reason I didn't bounce it as soon as I went back there is because I was going to delay. Nobody was in danger of dying, so I was basically going to sacrifice myself, and I was going to delay for as long as possible before I went to bounce that. Because if it hits the wall, that's really bad. It's gonna destroy the whole room if it hits the wall. So I was going to wait until it was right against the wall, and then I was going to step in, I was going to sacrifice myself, and then that would give it all of that extra time to go all the way back to the beginning of the room. So that's the micromanagement, that's what I was thinking of there, when I did that attempt to save. I attempted to save people, but I guess it really wasn't that big of a problem. Why is this trash? Oh, I remember why. I have my sound up. There's a leatherworking pattern back here. And the tailoring pants that I don't have pattern. You don't have to watch our live stream as we're doing it. That could just be distracting. I don't. Somebody just went out of bed. Twisted witty banter keeps me at bay. My witty banter is hysterically bad. Because, not only am I, trying to play, but I'm also, trying to explain usually something that's totally different from, what I'm actually actively doing. So, there's, all these delays I noticed where I'm just can't do, all of these things that I'm trying to multitask at once. Oh, sweet! We get to start off with a hard combo. I barrier first for this. Thank you. Oop, wrong weapon. Oop, I was supposed to be getting all of the bubbles up on people. Oh. Why do I always do this? I swear. It's like clockwork. The way we do purple is like each of us get a group. I'm on group two. And as always, since you're a priest, use Prayer of Mending, like, pretty much on the tank on cooldown during this phase, because it does not add a stack of purples. What we looking at here? Okay, this time I'm actually going to read that correctly. And have purple up again instead of dark. Colors are so confusing. That sound that just like went off, that was the sound of my Shadow of Pain missing. I branched out of my group that I'm supposed to be working on there because Ari Ella just whispered me how to pronounce her name. They like only had one stack and the buff was about to fall off in like a second or something, so I just like threw a bubble out there and kind of stabilized their health. That's what I was thinking. I always do like smiting in between here. If you're having trouble like with the DPS race, and you're also troubling him, like if you don't outgear the heals enough to like handle one of the hard combos, which I don't know if that's even foreseeable anymore. I think if you're on a 10 man, regardless of your gear level, you should... Is this the hard phase? No, this is a kobold. Well, he's gonna die anyway, I'll just drop a barrier. It's not like anyone's in danger of dying. Also, just dump your mana here, you're gonna lose it anyway. It's not Bottled Wishes, it's... Bottled Wishes is just on my bar from when I was Shadow, and I haven't filtered it correctly, that's why it's showing up. That, basically, it came up on my bar because it's showing that all my cooldowns that are activate are ready again. The reason it's doing that is because that's at the end of my Engineering Tinker duration. The Engineering Tinker is a little red thing that's appearing right over here. Okay, so you know how in Looking for Raid, when you go up here, like to this top part, and you have to wait forever for that portal to spawn, there's always like some jackass mage that decides, oh, I'm gonna like put a portal Theramore right here, and like drops it. Pretty much like everybody knows that that's gonna happen, because it's Looking for Raid. The new thing to do is, like in the last Looking for Raid I was doing on my mage this like weekend, I put like one portal, and then I'm like, why stop at one portal? I should just like load this whole area up with portals, so I dropped like one of every single portal. Okay, so yeah, like here's some cool things you can do on this platform. If you're a mage, try to get all of the barriers, or all of the teleports, like, stacked up on one another. That was, like, really goofy when I managed to do that. And then another thing, if you're a priest, I don't think you could do this in Looking for Raid anymore, but you can stand on this edge that I'm, like, hopping up and down on. You can, like, I don't know if you can still do this, but basically, you can hop off this ledge and stand on the ledge beneath here, and then you can have another priest stand on this ledge. This priest that's on this ledge jumping up and down can life grip someone to the edge, and then the priest that's beneath them can life grip them off the edge. Good people to do this to are the main tank that are taunting down the dragons, because pretty much, like, you're on this platform for Ultraxian the longest in Looking for Raid, and you can, like, totally screw up the whole group. Because it's Looking for Raid, like, who cares? So that's another griefing potential that you can do by being a priest or a mage up here. You can also life grip through the portal, which you can't see, but the portal into this instance, you can life grip people through it. Like, if you go on the other side of the portal, just ride your mount, run around. I did it at the beginning of the stream tonight. Just life grip someone, and when they get gripped through the portal, they teleport out. It's just like something funny and stupid you can do. Trash is, like, silly easy, so I'm putting on my DPS weapon. Use of this whoever has aggro button. If you're not showing on your healer bars who has aggro, you're doing it wrong. Get your healing bars configured correctly, because it's, like, infinitely useful to be able to see the little red dots popping up of, like, who's about to take some hits. And if you're playing Discipline Priest, it's kind of like whack-a-mole, right? I think I'm actually going to talk about Fire Mages, like, maybe next week, yeah. Next week at the beginning of the stream when we have some downtime, or, like, maybe after the stream if there's some downtime. I'm not going to talk about, like, the Fire single target rotation, but I'm going to talk about, like, Fire AoE, because in my mind that wasn't, like, an easy thing to figure out when I first started playing my Fire Mage. Because, I mean, like, you know, previous to specking Fire, of course my specs were, like, Frost for PvP and, like, LOL Arcane for PvE. Get over here! I know some people play with their sounds and stuff, but one of the things that I keep meaning to do is getting that sound manipulator add-on and changing my life grip to just, like, yell out, "Get over here!" Like, it doesn't do that to the raid, it just does that to me, but it'll make me smile every time I use it. Okay, so, like, what we do for strategy here, which really sucks, is for Ice Lances, we just try to, like, throw people in it that don't have the debuff. We don't have any specific order or anything. I have to use my cooldown rotation. On Retrified, I do my barrier, or no, I do my paints up on the second, like, pretty much the second after any phase, like, so the second focus assault, that's what it's called. I'm like, what is that thing called that she does? So every second focus assault after a phase is when I drop my healing cooldown. Paints up first, barrier second. What we're doing right now is we're discussing, like, who's gonna go where for the lightning phase, like, because we do have pre-assigned spots to, like, run to. For a healer, I just stand in the middle and just, like, bomb flash shields and bubbles on the raid. Should go really smoothly tonight, because Ariel is a druid. So now we have, like, two druids, which are, like, the bomb spec on lightning phases. For the ice phase, can we run towards, one of these markers as a group? Oh, I didn't even see we're doing that. Okay, we're doing the everyone holding hands. You know, since we're doing this on normal, I have my easy mode weapon equipped, and I'm, like, not worrying about stacks of ice. I mean, I'll heal it, don't get me wrong. I'm, like, totally not worrying about it, but it's not something that's, like, my concern right now. I mean, look how laughably easy it is to heal through it. 13 stacks, and they're, like, not budging in health. It made a triangle between Rhett, Twisted, and Mid. We suck. Oh, it did? Well, that's just silly, because it made like a perfect triangle between the three of us. Beware. Bring it on, ice walls! By the way, we're intentionally dying here. If that wasn't obvious by me acting like a total derp, yeah, we're gonna die here, and reset this and do it on heroic. We're just basically doing the let's all hold hands achievement, which I don't really know who needed it, but I guess someone did. But don't worry, we're gonna do the suckiness that is Hagara heroic now. Thanks, Ghost! Resin me. Okay, now this fight, it can go so many ways. Past couple weeks, we've actually struggled with it, but, you know, we've also been in here on a stream on an off night, and we've, like, one-shot it, so let's see how it goes. It's all dependent up to, like, how good people are at standing in the ice lances, because it's pretty much what, like, screws us up every time, because even if we have, like, a bad, like, ice run around the outside of the room phase, you can still sort of recover from that. You know, situationally, like, there's a lot of our raiders that have a lot of good raid awareness that can, like, do all kinds of tricks to save people who are dying from bad stuff or who are, like, slowed down. So there's, like, a lot of cool stuff that can happen, but the, like, thing that always, like, kills us because we're a 10-man is the ice lances in just the normal phase where, you know, we're, like, tanking and spanking her. Right now we're discussing strategy. I can just like read it straight up, because, you know, maybe if you want to hear how we discuss strategy, it's in text. Um, Okay. Yeah, okay, so the exchange going on is alright for the ice phase. Start at square. We mark that on the room. Square is up there. Bloop. And if you get the frost debuff, dip into the bubble in the center. That's like the water bubble she creates, and a healer will dispel you. The reason we do that is because when you get dispelled, you drop a frost patch on the ground. If you drop it in that bubble that's in the middle of the room, it doesn't drop a frost patch. But you do take like continual damage while you're in there. And you don't have a whole lot of time to like dink around. Like if you have the debuff, you need to dart to the water bubble right away so we can dispel you, because if you wait too long, you're going to be so slow that you wouldn't be able to run there in time, because you're just going to slow to a halt, basically. So yeah, it takes a lot of personal responsibility per raider. Times RNG, because like you don't know which raider's getting it, and you can get it multiple times in a row. We used to just like run wherever we wanted in the ice phase, and the healers would just split up accordingly because all three of us could do the dispel. But what we're doing in this group tonight is we're trying to stay together as a group for dispels. Usually the mobile healer, which is Razian, is going to dip back and take the people that like fall behind, because when they get dispelled, the ice wall can pass you while you're in a water, like in the water bubble being dispelled. Ice wall can pass you, and then you're like separated from the rest of the group. So we, usually like our healers are pretty aware enough to like, you know, see who needs that. Okay, so, and then it says, mid will give lightning assigns. Then it says, like, in text, mid, just wrote out a quick macro, left side, sish to mid, crystal, mid, demon to crystal, demon to mid to crystal, mid vein, right side, ret to humidor crystal, humidor atrial to crystal, atrial to ghost crystal, so. Always try to get like a big super nuke of heal. I was typing to another one of the healers as we started, but like for that part, always get like a nuke of heals in there.
Five, four, three, two, one.
Beware.
Lightning. I should be building my Archangel stacks here, but I'm not, because I'm being lazy. There we go. Get bubbles out on people. Bubbles, bubbles, bubbles. Power infusion. Once people have weakened soul, I'm going to start bombing the room. I get my Shadow Fiend out there early. It's lucky that I got it in proc, but the reason I got it out there early is because that's when we blow Heroism, and Shadow Fiend benefits from Heroism, of course, so... Yeah. That's good, right?
Beware.
Ah, I got picked for an Ice Tomb. Heal Rhett. You saw how low our tank dip there. Yeah, that's what happens when Rhett gets picked. Or that's what happens when I get picked for an ice tomb. Sucks, right? Eh, I don't want that. Guy almost kited the Razian. Yeah, scaring me. Almost kited that debuff right into me.
Beware.
To the blue. I'm using mouse over healing here to heal up those people. Oh, cool, health stones. I never actually got that. Holla! You got it again, demon. Twisted! He's the coolest, I hear. Love being an engineer! What up? What you know about engineers? Guy kind of ran in a little bit far, so I just gripped him out of it. That's why I usually life grip once in here. A lot of these people. Oh, and another thing you can do for dispels, if you're having trouble with like raid awareness, like seeing if people are actually dispelled in the right place. You're back by Sitch, okay. That's a shame. I looked back there and I saw the two raiders that were behind were Rhett and Sish, and I saw Razian was with them, and I was like, okay, good, he's like being taken care of. But
beware.
And Rhett just used his land hands during that phase, so it's like extra super bad. This is my turn to, like I said, just alternate the every second out of a phase, do the my tank cooldown, and then also these ice tombs, and the dispriest, and dispriest can atonement heal through those ice tombs. All right, that was good. Our puggers really carrying their weight effectively in here, because usually we wipe a couple times on this stupid fight. Stupid fight that I hate. This is my least favorite fight in Dragon Soul. I don't think I've ever said that just because I'm not swinging my opinions around, but yeah, this fight, Hagara. I mean, it was designed pretty clever. Like, you know, it takes a lot of personal raid responsibility. I have to tip my hat to the designer because there's so many, like, little odds and ends that you can do to min-max, like, your performance on this, but I hate things that aren't that straightforward, like, because it makes diagnosing a wipe really hard. And even if you have the, like the best of best gear, it's still hard every week because you have to like execute correctly. Following exchange, I'm gonna make this public, Ariella. Following exchange, if you have a DPS spec, I can heal this. This is what I whispered to him. I do not, but I will sit and let you shine. Smiley face. Nah, just to heal it. This is me responding. Nah, just to heal it. You can take the reds. This is weird because I usually take the red, but he's a druid. Druids need it more than me. Green is bad for them, so. Like, I mean, green is bad for all the healers, but it's like extra bad for druids, and red is like the only thing that really gains a lot of value with them, so I'm gonna let him have red the whole time, and I'm gonna take green this week, which is kind of weird, so maybe I'll change my playstyle up a bit. I mean, usually I'm rolling atonements mostly anyway, but since I have green, that like takes all of the single target healing I'm doing and then redistributes it, so I'll probably bomb greater heal a couple times in the tanks to get that extra, you know, big bursts, like sum together and redistribute it, if you know what that means. And I'm not gonna out heal you, just I mean, on this fight I actually usually lose the healing meters because I'm just sitting here doing atonement the whole time. Even when I solo heal it, I spend like 40% of the fight doing nothing but smites. The last album we listened to was Trez's new album. It's called The Odyssey. Really cool independent artist that everyone should like check out and buy his music because he's like super cool and he remixes some really cool stuff too. This is Droid, another band that broke up. All my music is indie artists or people who broke up.
Get your pride.
think I'm missing. Am I fully buffed? Yeah. Huh. Weird. So this is really funny because, like, our group is so weird this week. The way we have it staying out is, like, Ariel and Mid, two really squishy people, are staying out for the first, like, explosion. And then I get to stay out for the second with, like, my druid, which is really weird because I usually don't do that. I mean, I can see what he's thinking. He's thinking, like, oh, like, this way we're not losing DPS from people, like, staying out and blowing their cooldowns or whatever. And the fight is going, like, so fast these days. Earbud? Earbud! What's this? In my face. There we go. It's because my head's too fat. Alright, so yeah, on this fight, as a disco priest, you can pretty much spend the beginning of it doing atonement heals. We usually fade, like, right as he comes out, and then we blow heroism, because, like, that's a good time to pre-pot, and everyone lines up their DPS cooldowns together with that heroism, so that was our initial strategy, when, like, the enrage timer was actually something to think about. We don't, like, the reason we're not doing it now is because we're exhausted from Hagara, because we're clearing this so fast that the heroism buff hasn't fallen off yet, but that's, like, a tactic if you're having trouble, like, getting that DPS out, you can do that. And also, if you're having trouble with DPS, check your healers. Like, it's always, like, this fight, healing-wise, can come in bursts, like, in terms of difficulty, and it's kind of, like, only at the fifth time is the only real phase, like, after the fifth stay out, when it gets a little dicey, because then it's expected that at least two healers have that buff out on them. So, alright, I need to get bubbles on Ariella and Mid. I don't think barrier's gonna be up again by the end of the fight, but pretty much, like, as soon as it comes up again by the end, I'm gonna use it on cooldown. Oh. Red buff's out. And you'll see here that I'm kind of switching up my atonement rotation instead of just, like, worrying only about atonement. Like, Sorry, I had to focus because I had to put two things on me before that explosion hit. Like, I'm trying to, like, weave the atonements in once the damage starts pulsing a bit, because then you can, like, you can keep that buff rolling up as close to, like, the 30-second cooldown time as possible. But the damage patterns are such that, like, you need to be rolling, like, prayer fueling at least twice every time. But then there's, like, a small gap in delay before the next pulse of shadow AoE goes out, so that's, like, what I'm thinking. Also, now that I'm an engineer, it's, like, silly easy for me to keep my mana up, because I can just always pop my engineering tinker. Pop my tinker with my, like, with Archangel and with my, my rapture timing, so. And I'm also trying to just, like, keep it as close to cooldown as possible here, because the healing is so low that it doesn't really matter, like, that I need to save the cooldown for anything in particular. Ghost and Rhett are the ones that are staying out this time, for those who are following at home. I don't really know where my DPS cooldowns are, but we're in execute range, and my warlock is usually pretty good about doing his execute like rotation to 99% optimal rotationness. So I'm just gonna like drop it on him. Blue buff, roll heals. I haven't used a single DPS cooldown. Actually, I should have used my little shadow critter at the start when we had heroism. Or not at the start, but like just now, like we had heroism about a minute ago. Should have gotten that. Okay, strategies on this next fight. Here are some cool tricks that your raid may not know, because nobody seems to do this in Looking for Raid or whenever I do pugs. I feel like I say it every time I come in here. Everyone who has dots, stand right here. The jumping Aladdin. Mother of... Okay, everyone who has dots, jump up and down right here, because... over here where my mouse is where the dragons spawn 6 seconds before combat. They're attackable, and those are the ones that are going to appear on either side of the ship. The faster you can get them down, the less deck fires that are going to go out. So, you can get as many dots on them as they fly overhead. That one flies over here, this side first, and then there's another one that comes up over this side. You can get dots on secondly, and this one that comes over here is the second, like it comes up after this first one. So that's why you stand on this side of the ship. Just clearing that up. But yeah, basically dot up the dragons, and by the time they land, they'll be at like 30% health, and you can just like burn them down. And you can reduce the amount of deck fire you have, because deck fire in this encounter is a buggy piece of crap, and it, like, no matter what, will spread to your entire ship. So, yeah, try to kill those dragons as fast as possible. They do less of those little tiny purple swirls you have to stand in. Less purple swirls means, like, less deck fire. Or, you know what I mean. You know what I mean. Kill those dragons faster. It also puts you ahead in DPS, which means you can focus down on the two adds that the tanks have. Less tank damage means more healer mana. And that means that everyone is just sitting around with their hands in their pockets waiting for a sapper to come out because you're that far ahead on DPS. So yeah, if you're not doing that cool little trick, you're really shorting yourself on making this encounter really cheese. The second part of this encounter, I wish I could help, but it's entirely subject to your deck fire, which for us always seems to be awful. So we're always like doing things like stacking up on the edge of the ship, which is just like really bad for avoiding that shockwave. Anyway, so what other tips and tricks on this encounter? Healers are really stressed on mana, or they could have like not be spending it at all. It's entirely over, like it's entirely how you spend your cooldowns during those big purple swirls. So tanks with 4-piece rotations can really cheese that. And then, like, a really rigid cooldown rotation you can choose. It's something else that'll really help. If you're having trouble with the big purple swirls or something, or it's, like, stretching you guys too far, and you're kind of good about standing in little purple swirls, you can have, like, one person soak it. You don't have to have, like, the whole raid stand in a big purple swirl. That was our strategy for the server first kill on this, is we had a dispersion for one of them. It was the fourth. Like, in the first one, we would do Spirit Link. Second one, we would do, like, a tank cooldown, which, our pally tank, Guardian. And then... the third one is when I dropped barrier, the fourth one we had a dispersion, and then the fifth one we had a mage that was fire just take it and cauterize himself. So yeah, that's a strategy if you're having trouble with that. And this encounter is entirely, like, will go smoothly if you're good at standing in those little purple squirrels. I did confirm that you can't just like stand in them by yourself now. That's something I thought maybe you'd be able to do, but sadly this is not the case. So you still have to like buddy up in this encounter. I'm not really going to worry about it, but theoretically, if you're like progressing on this, you should like buddy up with someone. Usually I stand right next to the healer, and the healer and I just like butt buddies the whole time, and then every time a purple swirl comes near us, we jump in it. So that's like one way to avoid confusion in purple swirls, and then you don't have people trying to jump in a purple swirl, realizing they have the debuff from the previous one, jumping out and then one-shotting their partner. Like, just keep a strict buddy system. If there's already two people in one, then you don't want to stand in it, because then you don't need to get that debuff unnecessarily. So that's how to do like a quick and easy organization of these little purple swirls. If you're on a 25-man, just laugh, because it's like super easy. Probably should get out the right weapon, correct? I do weapon twist for those who are retuning in. It's this icon right here. Cost a global cooldown, but spread out healing, condensed healing, DPS, heart song. That's how I have them all set up and interchanged. You see here I'm like doing mouse over healing. Instead of like looking at
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Talking a bit, that's why I like suddenly cut out. Whoops, I just stood in that. Oh, the screen is black, isn't it? Thank you, Sombrous. Check out what's going on.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Beware.
Sorry, team.
5, 4, 3, 2.
I'll get this screen. I'll get this like screen fixed in a second. Yeah, I just like let someone die because I'm sitting here troubleshooting my computer instead of focusing on the fight. Ugh. Okay, I know what happened.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Aw, oh, crud. I just used my, Shadow Fiend, but I really shouldn't have. There we go! Okay. Look at that! I'm good enough to actually raid and troubleshoot my computer as I'm raiding. Okay, The stream is back. Basically what happened there is I'm trying this new thing tonight. Remember that super project I'm working on where I'm like trying to get the video capture up so I can like capture this without using the audio from my music. I'm trying to like separate the three audio channels. So tonight I'm doing a run where I'm just like direct copying over like the video to see like how that would work performance wise. The answer is I just ran out of hard drive space. So I guess the limit is, what time is it? 10:40 here, so that means limit, stay alive, swish. What time did I start tonight? Okay, so man, I didn't even like clear 2 hours. That sucks. Oh shoot, I'm about to eat this, but that's okay because I'm a human. Oh man, nobody got to see that epic life grip because, like, the boss died. Oh well. Anyway, this video's back up again, which probably means my audio that I was also using to record this, because I'm recording the audio in a separate channel. It's also cool, because my hard drives are like, we don't have more space! Although I'm not using like big hard drives, I have a RAID 0 setup with, well, I mean, can't say brand specifics, but I have a RAID 0 setup with these old hard drives that I salvaged from another machine, so I'm not running with like stellar equipment for my secondary hard drives. The game that WoW is playing from is an SSD, which you can probably tell by my load times. That's why my load times are so fast, is I'm not using like an HDD, I'm using an SSD drive. Yeah, I'm totally maxed on that drive, that's why it wouldn't let me record anymore. Crap. So I guess raw video capture needs more than 500 or 600 gigs. I have 600 gigs to throw around. Although I think like 150 of them were taken up, so if you use 500 gigs. So yeah, dang it. I mean, in order to capture this stuff in raw cap, I need a couple terabytes of space. I'm still too cheap to like go out and buy hard drives at the pricing that they're at, because it's just like outrageous. Is my mic still okay? Everyone can still hear that, because it's the software I'm using for the to record my voice separately in a different channel. It's the one that's controlling my mic now, the days. Oh well, I mean, you kind of saw like what was going on in that fight, even though it was black for half a bit. Before it cut out, I was doing like mouse over healing. The way I do that is, dang it, I have to click my window. I use these for all of my heals, pretty much like everything that's key bound. So yeah, my bubbles. The way I'm like doing it is, like mousing over the nameplate, so I have a really good nameplate set on. This is called Tidy Plates, and this is the neon theme. Tidy Plates has a couple of themes, this is neon. So yeah, that's kind of like how I've been rolling that. Crap. Let's see if this is lagging. I'm talking and my voice is lining up, yeesh. Sorry, that just cut out again. I know the screen just cut out. I'm on dispel duty for spine, so like what I'm doing right now is I'm trying to get it on the tanks, because I don't think I'm going to have mana problems tonight. okay. Basically, after this first lift, it looks like I got my... Crap, just dispelled the wrong person. Wasted a glue ball. I got all three healers covered. I'm just gonna leave that. I'm trying to remember, is Humidor a tank? Oh shoot, it's a DPS. Oh well. He's covered now. I'm also gonna cut out the audio for a second. Guess we're staying ahead on healing. Virtual audio? Come up! Audio in 3, 2, 1, up! Okay, that should be better. I just like reset it, so hopefully it's in sync with my voice. You can really cheese this as a Discipline Priest because you can put bubbles on the people during these nuclear blasts who would normally not receive any healing and just like suddenly drop in health. They're not dropping so much in health. We're far enough ahead in healing that I'm actually going to help with the DPS here. Go group, DPS, DPS. Another thing you gotta watch out for as a priest, if you're disciplined, penance, like it turns your camera like all over the freaking place, so make sure you're pointing the right direction with your Maw that... Yep. For a second I'm like, is it called Maw the Dragon Lord? Just had a second doubt. Make sure you're pointing your Maw the Dragon Lord the correct way. Okay, what I'm doing here is I'm managing my Shadow Fiend. My Shadow Fiend was out and attacking the Tendon. The Tendon was about to die. Its Shadow Crawl came off cooldown, and I moved it to one of the little bloods that was hanging out. You don't want to do it before Shadow Crawl comes off cooldown, because then you're wasting time for it like running across the ground, and it's not doing any melee hits, whereas Shadow Crawl will like instantly... Shadow Crawl like instantly puts it where it needs to be, so that's what I was thinking there. Actually, let's get these off the healers, get that on the tank. No! Save, Twisted! Okay, so right now, one of my tanks has a double buff, which is good. I got them up on him just now. I got it on the rogue who didn't have it. So basically all of group 1 is taken care of. So this needs to go just to anyone group 2 besides Razian or Sish. I'm just gonna stop there. I'm gonna try to delay using my Hymn of Hope. I didn't use it on that last lift with my Shadow Fiend because not enough of us had taken damage yet. Not enough of us had, low enough mana. Like, I looked across the other three healers and we were still full enough to where most of my Hymn of Hope takes would have gone to a DPS instead of a healer, so I'm gonna wait to use Hymn of Hope with my Shadow Fiend a second time. I can probably get two Hymns of Hope off, but, I don't want to have it largely go into overheal, because think of it this way, if I would have saved Hymn of Hope here, yes, I'm only using it once per encounter, but I also wasn't sitting there, channeling for, 5 seconds. Which, I mean, those 5 seconds is a lot of last healing, so... Grip, always have your life grip ready for that Nova. You might need to grip someone out of the way. just lined up two end procs with my Archangel for the extra mana return. I was kind of hoping I'd proc another one. I was kind of like still weaving heals in, like instant heals while bubble. Just trying to get that to proc this other end proc while I was doing my DPS rotation to build the stacks for Archangel so I could return more mana. I'm just gonna let that sit on Razian because he's notorious for taking lots of aggro on the last phase. So I'm just gonna. I mean, it's situational. Like, if it wasn't him, like, I would probably, like, keep dispelling it. Like, if it was on our shaman, I'd dispel it to someone else yet again. But he's, like, really, really good at taking aggro because of his hots. So that's why I, like, dispelled it off of him just now. Kind of have to make some split second decisions like that if you're the dispeller. Healed there. That was a mistake. I meant to not penance that. I'm not used to raiding with these guys, which is why I like just did that. I didn't mean to grip Ariella. I didn't see that that was the person that had it just now. I just like saw someone's gripped and like just freaked out. Switching my heart song weapon because I'm running a little bit low on mana. And like I said earlier, I want to see how far I can get with before using my Hymn of Joke. Alright, Shadow Fiend's up. See if I can get an end proc rolling here, and I'll try to reset my mana. Oh well, it's not happening. Switching back to my other weapon here, I need to get it out for the extra healing. Divine Hymning here. Love it when that happens. Oh crap, I meant to use that on Demon. Oh well. Durr. I mean, we don't have like our biggest burst DPS in the raid right now, so there's no shame in not getting that down in one lift. Like, that's what we're trying to do. Actually, Reason already has that. Can probably get that to someone else. Go to someone who doesn't have it. That's good too. It's okay to kind of dump my mana a bit here. Like I said, make sure you're showing aggro there. Midvayne would have died if I hadn't been showing that aggro dot and saw that he was like cleaving some aggro. Nicely on hands from my tank. To another tank. Free mid. That's great. Mind the range DPS with their job. No, I know why they weren't doing that. It's because it was too far away. They're busy finishing this fight. Okay. And I don't have to focus forever and ever and ever. So yeah, the classes that are really awesome on this particular fight's fine. If you have like a Holy Pally that can do beacon on two targets, you can drop that debuff twice as fast. Another, like, in my opinion, mandatory class is a Discipline Priest, because on Novas, if you have the debuff, that's where people get gibbed, is because they have that like Searing Plasma buff on them, and a Nova happens and it like wipes them. That Nova, okay, there's an explanation. That Nova can like drop people. If you have a Dispriest in the raid, they can do like 100% effective healing on the person that has that debuff during those Novas and keep them alive. If you saw, that's where I was putting my bubbles out. Bubbles are a finite resource in that fight because it's so long, and Rapture is hard to proc if once you get the tanks buffed with their mandatory buffs that you're dispelling the blood of Nathalion or whatever. So that's something else you need to be mindful of as a Dispriest, is you need to manage your mana probably a bit better than you normally do. Which is why, like, during that last fight, I was doing all that commentary on, like, what I was doing with my mana. I was thinking about, like, ways I could, like, squeeze out just a little bit more. I was actually kind of playing lazy and sloppy at the beginning. I didn't switch to Inner Will for all the dispels, and I realized, like, oh, I didn't do that, but I'll probably be fine. And then I looked at it, my mana bar, and I wasn't fine. I should have switched to Inner Will for that. I mean, another reason why this is awesome is because, you know, your range DPS could be like the best timing range DPS in the world, but something is going to stop them from instantly blowing up the grips, like those fiery grips that are going out. So having a Dispriest in the raid is awesome because you can bubble the person as soon as they're gripped if you're showing the debuff. So basically, if you have a Dispriest who can configure their UI, you can do a lot to help the raid. Although I will say this. Discipline on Spine has the slowest ramp-up time for a single target because you have to get Grace rolling in order to keep up with the other healers, and you also like have probably, even with Grace stacked, the lowest healing per second going out, depending on how you're stacking your stats, because you want Mastery for that fight, for those clutch bubbles, but every point of Mastery you have is something that could have been put into Crit and Haste, which would have made you more normalized with the other raiders in terms of their raw healing per second, because you need Crit for Aegis on your greater heals, and you need Haste to get the greater heals off faster. We're just discussing madness. It's pretty similar to normal. Just make a cone better so that laydown doesn't blow up your raid when the tentacle's out. Also, the order, we even do the order in the same thing, but there's basically like one more ad that spawns on these four platforms. I think it's called Corrupting Parasite. It comes on a radar, on one of the raiders, and then it explodes after like 5 or 10 seconds. It's a long duration, like 8 seconds maybe. You need to make sure you're standing in the slowing circle that the yellow dragon puts on the ground. I'm not reforging anything because I'm lazy. I used to swap around a lot of gear. Here's what I... When we first did this, I had my 2-piece set bonus from Firelands tier heroic, because I had, like, normal mode tier. Because I was one of the last people to get geared. I intentionally sat in a lot of the gear upgrades in normal mode, like the couple of times we did it. So... basically,